Hi, this is Graham from Genom's Astro. Today I'd like to review this, the ZWO Atmospheric Dispersion Corrector. Now the idea of an atmospheric dispersion corrector is that it can improve your view of planets that are close to the horizon. So this could be when you're visually observing them or when you're imaging them. And what it does is it tries to take away an effect that's introduced when the planets are low down and the different wavelengths of light are dispersed or separated as they travel through the thick lower atmosphere. So inside this device there are a couple of prisms and you can adjust them as we'll see shortly, and the idea is that it can remove the effects that you see either in the eyepiece or on an image of that dispersion of light. So in a way it's similar to having a telescope that has false colour, and this device is aiming to reduce or remove the false colour. In the UK, it's for sale for around £115. Okay, so what's in the box? Well, not much as it turns out, just the device itself. Don't expect any instructions. So we'll see how we get on. First thing to notice is that it's a device that will fit into a 1¼-inch draw tube on one side, and then on the other side, you'll be able to connect a camera or a diagonal or eyepiece. You can see that it's got a spirit level here, which is basically because you need to have this device fitted such that it's horizontal against the horizon when you're adjusting it. So that's something to bear in mind as you when you found your target in your telescope. And other than that, what can you see? Well, it looks like we've paid quite a bit of money for not very much, because you can see straight through it. But it turns out that there are actually two prisms inside the unit, and the correction that it applies is by rotating these prisms relative to each other. And it does that by means of these two levers. So you have two levers that can be moved independently of each other like so. So you can move them so that they're pointing in completely different directions, or you can bring them back to be in a datum position like that. And on the side of the body of the unit you can see some graduations to allow you to perhaps to reproduce a given position, or to make sure that the two levers are adjusted symmetrically, so they should always be up and down by the same amount. So how are we going to connect it? Well, I'm going to use SkyMax 127 and then a 2x Barlow and a ZWO ASI 120 camera. So these are the standard parts of setup I use for imaging, and when we use the ADC we're going to put in the Barlow as normal into the visual back. It doesn't go fully in on the SkyMax, but that's okay. It's not really elegant, but it reaches focus. Then we're going to attach the ADC. So that goes in here behind the Barlow, and we tighten it up. And then finally, we're going to put the camera into the ADC, like so. And that is the basic setup we're going to use. We're going to take a few videos of Venus and experiment with the settings of the ADC. So before we do that, the only other thing to note really is if you have a slightly different setup, if you don't need to use a Barlow and you have like this scope, a case where your visual back has a T-thread, then the ZWO body comes apart and you can then reveal a thread which allows you to mate the ADC directly onto the back of the visual back, like so. So that can give you quite a nice secure connection if you don't need to put anything between the visual back and the ADC. But in our case, I'm going to use a 2x Barlow to get a larger image scale. So this is the first capture. So initially, the levers on the ADC are horizontal, or they're at the zero position. So they are adjacent to the datum screw, little screw you can see behind the levers, and also you can see that the ADC itself is oriented horizontally with the horizon, so there's a little bubble level on the top which allows you to set the horizontal axis. On the right you can see the image. This is a 500 frame capture that's on a loop, and I think it's pretty clear that the fringing, you can see the dispersion of the colour is quite evident. So on the upper side as we see it, there's quite a lot of red and yellow, and on the lower side there's a distinct blue tint. So clearly in this case the zero position on the ADC is not removing the dispersion. So this time the levers are separated up to the first division either side of the datum. So I'm calling this the 0.5 position, but each lever is adjacent to the first of the marks on the side of the ADC body. So looking at the difference, well, the fringing has pretty well disappeared, I'd say, compared to the first capture. So this looks to be approximately the right position to get rid of the fringing. So we'll process the image later and see whether indeed the colour has been removed. So now the levers are separated to be adjacent to the first bold mark on each side of the body. So I'm calling this position 1, and looking at the image, perhaps there's a little bit of orange, a little bit of colour on the left hand side of the planetary disk as we see it here. It comes and goes. I think you can just about perceive a little bit of fringing, but no significant colour, I'd say, on either the north or the south of the planet. So now the levers are both separated by 1.5 of the major divisions either side of the datum, and it's, I think you can see from the image, the video, that there is now some evident yellow orange fringing on the lower side of the planet and some blue on the top. So the fringing that we saw on the datum position of a zero is swapped over, so we're obviously applying too much correction here. And to find the optimum position, we'd probably have to go back to a smaller offset of the levers. So finally, last capture, this one, the levers are adjacent to the second major bold marker on each side of the ADC body. So I'm calling this position 2. It's pretty clear from the image that the fringing has got worse, as you would expect. And now we can see quite a lot of orangey yellow on the lower side and quite a lot of blue on the top. Okay, so here are the results. So what I've done is I've taken the AVI file, put it through the PIP tool in order to centralize the image of Venus because my tracking wasn't very good, and then I've taken each of those files and processed them in Registax in exactly the same way. So I've done a basic alignment and stack, and then we've taken the best 100 frames out of the 500 frames in the file, and performed a very basic wavelet adjustment. So there's no color adjustment whatsoever in Registax. So moving from the left to the right, I think we can see that when the ADC is applying no correction, we've got some fringing, and then somewhere around the 0.5 to the 1 position, the color dispersion is removed. So clearly in this example, that's roughly where we want to put the levers. And then moving over to the right, as we've separated the levers further, the fringing has come back in an opposite sense to where it started with zero correction. So I think the ADC has done the job. Venus is always a difficult target. It's always low in the sky, very bright, and you're always, in my case at least, I push for time as the planet tends to set behind one of my neighbour's houses. So everything's a little bit rushed, and it was quite straightforward to use the ADC both photographically and also visually. Quite intuitive once you get used to the fact that you've got to keep the ADC level using the spirit level, and to keep to adjust the levers symmetrically, as it were. So pretty happy with that. I'll leave it to you to compare the results versus using the color adjustment tool in Registax, but for me it's done the job, and I look forward to using the ADC on the other planets, particularly Jupiter and Saturn. So, hope it's been useful. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.